About as soon as Joseph was gone, the train brought in sporting tourists, loggers, prospectors, market hunters, land agents, surveyors, and spruce gum gatherers, all of whom called the lake Bonaparte rather than Diana. Joseph Bonaparte's son-in-law, Zebulon Benton, who wore a sidewise hat like Napoleon, built a dam a mile below the outlet of the lake and then a 30-foot pyramid of sandstone in which to melt iron ore. To do this, Benton had to build a village for his workers and haul the iron ore by ox cart 30 miles through the woods from Benson's mine. The dam didn't generate enough power to justify placing the smelter there, but it did raise the lake level a few feet and make islands of what had formerly been several piney peninsulas. The largest of these islands was a high, round one up against the west shore. Just a few yards inland behind it was a pond of about the same size, looking from the bluff behind like the hole from which the rocks to make Round Island were gouged. In the joints of that plated granite, someone discovered clear sheeted mica and opened a small pit mine. But the mica mine and the iron smelting operations proved unprofitable. The wood frame village of Alpine, as Zebulon Benton named it, although there were no mountains around and the natives now called it Alpine instead of Alpine, soon fell into its own foundation, which I first remember as sunken raspberry gardens. The sandstone smelter was soon mounted by moss and sumac, crumbling like the Mayan ruins in the old National Geographics by our big camp fireplace. But before Zebulon Benton's civilization at the west end of the lake had begun to crumble, the loggers had brought the biggest of the trees out of the woods and pulled them across the lake to the train. In the newly opened woods, berries and browse increased, and so did the deer herds for a while. Market hunters with dogs drove every last deer out into the lake, slaughtered them, and hauled the meat to New York City in boxcars. The next wave of people camped, picked berries, and fished for trout for 10 years as forest fires swept through the dry slash of the lumbered woods and over the backs of the rhinoceros hills. Joseph's Lodge burnt down too. Near its site, the New Hermitage Hotel opened to democratic sporting types who often rode their own boats. The higher water gave a boost to the smallmouth bass population, and fishing for the bass became especially famous. My great-grandfather, the doctor from the village of Natural Bone, and for all around Bonaparte, built a camp on the hotel shore. Others followed. Irv Priest, back from Florida with a collection of animal curios, opened a general store, soda fountain, souvenir stand, roller skating rink, and marina, decorated indoors with the rattlesnake skins, seashells, stuffed swamp cats, and sand sharks from Florida. This is where we were to get our camp groceries, block ice, and mail until long after Irv Priest had become an old man, resembling Uncle Sam's own great uncle with a pointed white beard and wide suspenders which seemed to be hunching him down by the weight of his pants.